All right, so let's move on. We now move on to our other judge story, North Carolina, and whatever.
Yes, in North Carolina, a judge has struck down a new law prohibiting tenure in the state. And so that's what you call an activist judge, I suppose. The law actually says, the interesting thing if you read this story is the law actually says that in North Carolina, teachers can't be fired except for reasons including, and it lists the reasons, and one of them is poor performance. So it's curious that that doesn't actually happen a whole lot.
Well, curious, that's the norm. Nowhere in the country does that seem to be ever used.
But so. The judge declared this a 10-year ban unconstitutional as unreasonable and unnecessary.
I see. Unreasonable. And this is, yes, that was the part that made me crazy. And of course, I've learned now that Dick Comer is perfectly fine with activist judges who make up laws they see fit. I'm surprised to hear that. But it does say here, yeah, this is the part. Is this just the guy's own personal political views? He says abolishing tenure was not necessary to serve an important public purpose. He, you know, Judge Hobgood said in his ruling, in my opinion, this isn't necessary. I just don't happen to favor this policy, so I'm going to say, let's junk it and get rid of it. So, go ahead, Dick.
Well, I think that this actually goes back to what we were talking about before, which is that normally when a state wants to abolish tenure, the way they do it is to recognize that the current teachers have accepted these jobs and have sort of vested rights as to how they can be removed. In the same way that other employees, including employees of private companies, oftentimes have state law protections against being fired for just any reason whatsoever.
So that's the usual justification for holding on to tenure is that they're kind of grandfathered?
No, that's for holding on to tenure to those people who have come into the system under tenure as a part of their contract.
That's what I mean. But
it's
grandfathered
contract
in.
Law.
Right.
But new teachers, of course, and I don't believe that Hobgood's ruling extends as far as new teachers. The legislature's perfectly free, I believe, to abolish tenure for new teachers and to say, henceforth, going forward, you have no right to tenure after 4 years in North Carolina. Now, there's also, I think, the very real possibility that he's wrong about the idea that you can sort of get people to voluntarily waive tenure by offering them a higher yearly salary. And that's also a part of this lawsuit.
Right.
So that's an important clarification. That as well.
Yeah, you made. If we could just actually show the website here, it does say that the ruling did not include teachers that were hired with the expectation of having tenure rights after 4 years, but had not yet reached that milestone. In other words, new teachers. New teachers can be hired without a claim to tenure rights. So his judge is just, his decision is just protecting tenure for those grandfathered in, those who are already, those have been around long enough. Apparently, at least the new teachers don't have to be offered this kind of guaranteed job for life. So that's right. The silver lining, perhaps.
That is the silver lining, and you know we'll have to see how this plays out. I should mention that Judge Hobgood is also the judge in the North Carolina scholarship case where we're representing the parents, and he's the guy who basically has screwed the 2,400 families that were entitled to receive scholarships this year up until last week when the North Carolina Supreme Court put his preliminary injunction on hold.
Right. It does seem to me, and doesn't it to you, that these guys have a political point of view. It's either they're for reform or against it, and whatever side of that divide they're on, all their decisions seem to line up along one side. Is that generally true?
I think that that is generally true of judges. They're human beings, and like all of us, they have certain preconceptions.
Yeah.
And one of the strongest preconceptions, particularly of people who are my age or older, are public schools good, public schools as an article of faith. Everyone should send their kids to the public schools because they were educated in the public schools themselves at a time when the public schools for most white families were doing a pretty good job.
Yeah.
But
at the same time, they usually don't get annoyed with when presidents of the United States send their kids to private schools, that's usually considered fine, right?
That's right.
Yeah. Or wealthy rich people or Hollywood actors or, you know, even Matt Damon, who famously went on a Reason TV video talking about how essentially, tenure was great and whatnot, you know, defending the establishment. Then turns out he sends his kids to private school, you know.
Well, of course, because, you know, everybody wants the best for their kids.
Right.
And as long as poor people don't have the wherewithal to send their kids to private schools, it's great. Because then the rich, like Matt Damon, can give their kids a competitive advantage by sending them to better private schools.
All right.
But if the poor kids can go to the same...
We want to offer Matt Damon the right to respond to this disparagement of his character here on the air on Choice Media Reform School. If he chooses, we'll be happy to welcome his response.